Going to start the webinar. And right now we are recording this so that we can put it up on the website. So anyone who has not been able to join us today will be able to have access to it. So if you are joining us now, you will be able to send in any questions that you would like to ask to the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. If you're familiar, as I bet many of you are by now, with Zoom, at the bottom of the screen, there's a Q&A function. It looks like two speech bubbles. Just type in your question. It'll come to us and we will get the right person to answer it. The chat function does not work during this webinar. So send all your questions in through Q&A, please. And because there are so many people coming in, raising your hand is not an effective way for us to see it. So please do send in any questions. Again, if you are one of the people who's just rolled in to join us, we are recording this session and looks like we've got quite a large critical mass here with us now. So I think we should be safe in starting and new people will be able to roll in as they arrive. So what I am going to do now is welcome all of you back first to the 21-22 school year. We are very, very excited. The staff has been working all summer getting things ready, and we're really excited about seeing new students tomorrow and then all of our students returning on Monday the 30th at 8:20 a.m. How's that for reminding you the start time? I am going to now introduce our panelists, and we have a wonderful team of folks here who can answer your questions. The focus of this town meeting tonight is on our COVID protocols and our school reopening plan for the 21-22 school year. And first, I'd like to introduce our new head of school, Richard Thornhill. Richard is here with us. Richard, you want to say hello?
Good evening and welcome everyone. And I have to say that I've been looking forward to this moment for a long time. So it's sort of you get appointed and you look forward to it and the anticipation builds and we're finally nearly there. So very excited to be here. Boston's a lovely place. Had a little look around. Just fantastic to be here. I'm also joined Emma Northey will obviously be leading a lot of this. But from our perspective, it was very important that Emma contributed to this using all her experience and expertise gained over the previous years and also to help with the transition. So I'm very grateful for the huge amount of work that Emma's done and hopefully we'll all be able to answer your questions. But I think the focus will be very much on Emma this evening. But so a huge thank you, Emma. That's much appreciated. And it's been a huge help to both myself and Andrew, who is joining us as well. So I hope you find the meeting useful. I'm very pleased to be here and I'm looking forward to hearing all of your views, not just this evening, but in future meetings. Thank you, Lisa.
Fantastic, Richard. And now over to Andrew Gilhooley. Andy is our new deputy head of school and has just joined us here in Boston with his wife and two children. So we're really excited to have a whole new family with us. Andy, you want to say hello?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. And thank you so much for all the people who've gone on the call tonight. And it's really exciting actually to be doing one of these calls with you all. Yeah, but we've only been here a very short amount of time, my family, but this is what an amazing city we found it and what amazing staff we've met. And actually, though, I'm really looking forward though, to seeing anyone who's brand new on this call. Hopefully I'll see you tomorrow. I'm really looking forward to seeing all the students and hopefully most of you again when we return to school on Monday. But yeah, it's great to be here. I'm really excited. Thank you.
Fantastic. And now is Emma Northey, our friend and co-worker. Ems, you want to say hello to everyone?
I will. Hello, good evening and welcome back. Lovely to see, or virtually to see the names of, lots of familiar friends and old faces, and welcome to lots of new families who are joining us this year or joining the school this year. I'm actually not working at the school technically, but I am doing some work just on a consultancy basis around the COVID support. So really looking forward to having the opportunity to see lots of you and to hopefully be able to answer questions and run through with the reopening plan tonight.
Fantastic. So what I'll do now for everyone out there is I'm going to switch over to speaker view so that you'll be able to to see EMS more clearly. And EMS is going to walk us through the reopening plan, and then we will open back up and answer questions. I see some questions are coming in and we will be able to answer those. I will be cognizant of the time. We'll try to stay on our schedule, and any questions that don't get answered tonight, do not worry. We promise we will get you an answer in writing. We'll get everything answered. So EMS, I'm gonna now switch over, and if you'd like to start, that would be wonderful. Thanks.
Absolutely. Well, so I don't think any of us thought we would be here in this place again this year. We were very much told at the end of last year, when we started to be able to move to some sort of normalcy, that things would look better at the start of the school year. However, as I'm sure you're all aware, the Delta variant and some of the other variants have slightly put a spanner in the works there and have forced everybody to slightly rethink. So first of all, apologies for the delay in getting out information around COVID, but we had to wait for the most recent guidance, which literally only came out, in fact, some of it came out today, some of it came out at the beginning of this week. So we've really been waiting to get the most recent guidance before we could share information with the school. So at the end of last year, Massachusetts Department of Elementary and Secondary Education said that they were actually going separate ways from the Board of Health. About a week ago, or 2 weeks ago, they came back and said, actually, no, we're not. We now need to work with the Board of Health with everything that's changing with the Delta variant. And they've come together and they put out shared guidance for schools to follow. Obviously, private schools don't actually have to follow the DESE guidance. They do have to follow Board of Health. We do have to follow city guidance, state guidance, and federal guidance. So a while ago, we were told that it was unlikely that masking would be needed to happen in schools. We held off as long as we could to see what was going to happen. We felt very strongly that as the majority of the school community are unvaccinated, the younger students, etc., that masking would be important. As it turned out, and as we thought was going to happen, it's become a mandate. It was mandated yesterday. It was mandated until October for K through 12 schools. Obviously our school goes younger than K, but we are still abiding by that. Then from October, the recommendations are if your school is 80% vaccinated, that then you can move to optional masking. Just a heads up, it is highly unlikely that the British school will move to unmasking. It wouldn't even be thought of, I wouldn't think, before December. But also we're not going to be 80% vaccinated anyway. So I think that's going to be a moot point. Obviously, as you all know from last year, the guidance fluctuates literally on a daily basis. And a lot of the things we've put in place in the reopening plan are great on paper. And as we discovered last year, sometimes they don't always work in operation. So some of these things, please bear with the school. We've done our best to get it out so that it looks efficient, it's effective, it's meeting all the criteria, but there may need to be slight tweaks. So please do bear with us if that has to happen. We've erred on the side of caution. We have gone as extreme as we can be, but also what we really needed to do was to get the school back to some sort of normalcy. We needed to bring back things like extracurricular. We needed to bring back aftercare. We needed to have trips. We needed to have children being able to actually socialize outside, et cetera. So one of the biggest changes you're going to see in the reopening plan is the expanding of cohorts. So last year we had cohorts that were only done by grade. This year they're not, they're slightly expanded. So we've got early years, so toddlers through to year two, years three through six as a cohort, and then middle and high school. And the reason that's happened is that we couldn't have operated with things like extracurricular. It was very, very difficult to staff last year when we had so many small cohorts. We couldn't have had anything like clubs, lunchtime activities, all those types of things couldn't happen whilst the cohorts were so small. So that was one of the main reasons that we've expanded the cohorts. I'm just going to run through the reopening plan, and you will all have received it. It's very long, I apologize for that, but it was important to try and preempt as many of the questions and the operational sort of hiccups we may have come across. So just to go through it, we have spoken with so many different agencies. Just like last year, we've spoken with the Board of Health, we've spoken with DESE, we've spoken with Boston Public Health, we've spoken with doctors, pediatricians, scientists, everybody we can to try and get the best advice and the best guidance. The difficulty at the moment is that the Delta variant really is sort of surprising everybody. It's affecting children more than they thought it was. And I think the other biggest issue that they're coming across is that even when people are vaccinated, there are so many breakthrough cases of vaccinated people. So a lot of people have been asking us why all the students need to mask, for instance, why we're still continuing with testing. Vaccinated people can still carry the virus and transmit the virus. They just won't become so sick. So it's really important for us that we start the school as clean as possible. That's why we're asking everybody to test before they come back to school. And the reason for that, I'll talk a little bit more about the state testing, but that was one of the conditions with the state testing. So you'll see in the reopening plan, I'm not going to go through every single stage of it, but I'm going to go through some of the biggest changes and the things that you're going to see that are slightly different from the reopening plan last year, or if you're new to the school, that might be of importance to you. So the bubbling and the cohorts are obviously slightly different. The children understand the cohorts well. They worked really well within the cohorts last year and really understood it. I think children are a lot more resilient than perhaps even we as adults are. And they were very, very flexible. They were very good about wearing their masks. They were very good about understanding about physical distancing. The state guidance around physical distancing has actually been dropped, which is surprising, but we decided to err on the side of caution and followed the CDC guidance, which recommended at least 3 feet. So last year we opened at 3 feet, and you'll remember a lot of public schools were not able to open because the unions were asking them to open at 6 feet. That was why most of the public schools didn't open until much later, because they couldn't physically fit everybody in their buildings. We did rip the Band-Aid off and opened at 3 feet. We managed to make it work very well. The children were very respectful of the distancing, and we managed to stay open all year last year, as you know. There will be some slight changes to common spaces, for instance. Last year, we really didn't use any of the common spaces, like library, like sort of corners under the stairs for reading, things like that. This year, they will be used, but they'll only be used by children of the same cohort at the same time. So, I mean, they'll be sanitized between, but we will be using some of the more common spaces. I say we, I mean the school will. Mask wearing. All students will be required, and all staff, to wear masks. We do ask that you look at the CDC guidance around masking. They are saying that certain masks are not really acceptable and not really doing very much. We also are very aware that this guidance isn't going to please everybody. I've sat through a number of school committee meetings recently where there have been people who have argued both sides of masking or not masking. We know that there is a lot of data for both sides. At the moment, we have no choice. It's a mandate. And we do feel that the benefits of being able to be in school in person outweigh the masking, the things that go against being masked. Just going on to hand washing and sanitization, that will all stay the same. There are sanitizers outside the school, outside each classroom. The supplies and equipment will be sanitized regularly. The classrooms have all been configured to ensure physical distancing is met and can be adhered to. Another difference is that the students will be able to use, middle and high school students will be able to use their lockers. Sorry if I'm looking over to the side, it's because I've got two screens and I've got the reopening plan open on this screen. So they will be able to use lockers, but again, we will be obviously discouraging students gathering around lockers. PE locker rooms and changing rooms will not be opened. They will remain closed, so students will need to wear PE clothes to school on the days that they have their PE, and those will come out on the timetables. You'll see when your child has PE. The daily health screener we've actually scrapped. That's one thing that's gone. The reason for that was that it really wasn't an effective measure. One of the things we discovered was that we spent a lot of time calling families in the morning to remind them to do the health screener. And generally the families we were calling were not the parents that we really needed to keep on top of. Everyone that did the health screener were the people that were being super supportive and super responsible. It was really not a particularly helpful measure for us as a school. So I think we just have to base this again on trust and hope that people act responsibly, keep their children home if they're sick. We will send home symptomatic children because we can't have them in school, obviously, and take that risk at the moment. With regards to signage, hallway routes, a lot of that will be very similar. There'll be signage around the school. Students will be encouraged to walk on one side of the corridor, all those types of things. Parents and visitors will, there was a lot of information in there around visitors. It will be limited. A lot of the large gathering events like back to school nights, etc., will be virtual to start with. Whole school staff meetings will be virtual, but we will be following Massachusetts guidelines on gathering and things like that. So visitors will be allowed into the school. Lisa's admissions tours, for instance, will be able to happen, but with very strict guidelines around masking, physical distancing, etc. Going on to cleaning, there will be enhanced cleaning continuing. The school does get a deep clean every day, but there will be cleaners in school regularly. The teachers are very familiar, and actually the children are very familiar with sanitizing and cleaning after them during the day as well. With regards to water fountains, we will still not be using the water fountains for obvious reasons. There are water dispensers around the school, and children should bring water bottles every day, obviously. Health and safety policies. The teachers have all been trained on the health and safety policies. They will have regular discussions around protocols, any changes, any updates. School uniform. Last year, we were quite lenient around school uniform because one of the guidance said that uniform had to be washed every night. The reality is blazers and ties, etc., cannot be washed every night. So what we're saying now is that they do need to be washed regularly, but that we are going to tighten up on the school uniform because the children were slightly making the most of not to having to wear correct uniform last year. If somebody becomes sick, they will be sent home. They'll be sent to the nurse's office. They will be sent home. We will still ask families to collect students immediately if they are sick. School will follow state guidance on buses and transportation. One of the new pieces of guidance says that trips, etc., can happen, but bus trips are not allowed to take more than 1 hour. So no trip will happen where children will be on a bus for longer than an hour. Bus transportation will just carry on. They will have assigned seating on the buses to help with contact tracing. If there's any school in-school transmission, one of the things we were very proud of last year, which is slightly sad we've been saying that, but we were proud last year that we had no in-school transmission at all. We did have positive cases. We knew we would have positive cases, but we had no in-school transmission, meaning that nobody caught it from somebody else in school, which showed that the protocols we had in place really were working. So obviously, as soon as there is a positive case, all of the relevant people will be told immediately. If there's a positive case in school, the community will be told, but then close contacts will be contacted immediately. Close contacts is slightly different. We're just trying to get the final criteria from the Board of Health, who are slightly going backwards and forwards. I had two calls with them today, and there still seems to be a bit of discussion around the difference between vaccinated and unvaccinated people and close contacts and the quarantining requirements. We will get that out to you as soon as possible. The dashboard that we ran last year, helped by one of the parents, was very helpful, and we had a lot of very positive feedback about it. I think it just helped people to understand what the city data looked like, the state data looked like, and what it actually looked like within our school, bearing in mind that we draw from over 40 different districts around Massachusetts. Each town has their own data, and Boston has its own data. I think we have to remember that Boston is much bigger than people realize, and therefore their data is sometimes slightly skewed. But we were running our own data based on the 40 or the districts that we pull children from. So our data was very, very specific to the school, and we will continue with that if we feel it's useful and if parents can still consider it to be useful. School arrival and dismissal. There's obviously been a big change around going back to the original times that we used to open and close. So drop off is between 8 and 8:20. There's been very specific information that came out about where children should be dropped. We've had quite a few questions about what happens if you have children in different phases of the school. Please just do as you normally would have done. So you can drop at the lower, drop with your youngest child, and the older children can make their way to wherever they need to be. Don't worry about whether they'll get to the right place. There are a lot of people who know where to send them. But yes, work with your youngest child. So if your youngest child needs to be dropped at the lower parking lot, please drop your oldest one there as well, and they will go to wherever they need to be. With regards to, we've had some questions about what happens if it's raining outside, etc. All of those logistical questions will be communicated to you from the school. But obviously, there are places for them to go. They will go directly into their classrooms. If it's raining or the weather's not conducive to them being outside. but those types of logistical questions will be, or answers will be communicated to you from the school. Moving on from arrival and dismissal, if there are questions around that, please do contact the school, but I want to try and keep going on the COVID stuff where possible. The timetable has been adapted enough that we are able to have the children not coming, bumping into each other at the sort of staggered lunches, etc. We've had a lot of questions around devices. So last year, a lot, in fact, pretty much everything was done on devices, on laptops or on iPads. This year, the students can use exercise books, will be using exercise books. They will continue in the lower school to use Seesaw for some things. Seesaw is the online platform where the children had a digital portfolio. The main reason for that is if, God forbid, the school has to go virtual at any point because of an outbreak or a mandate from the city or the state, then at least the students' work is contained in one place. So they will continue to use Seesaw, but they will be using a lot more exercise books, etc. Moving on to lunches. The children will be back in the cafeteria from year three upwards, which I'm sure you're thrilled to hear. There is a new lunch service. I'm sure that there'll be information coming out from school around that. They will only sit with their own cohort. So the lunches are staggered so that they're only having lunch with their own cohort. That is obviously a mask break, and Leader Saram has spent a lot of time over there measuring out and making sure that the children are going to be distanced. In the classrooms on the lower floor up to year two, where they'll eat in their classrooms, they have done the same thing and will make sure that the children are physically distanced enough so they can take their masks off. Recess, they will be outside with their own cohort. They will not have designated spaces as they had last time. So last year they had sort of cordoned off sections of the outdoor space. This year they won't have that, but they will only be out there with their own cohort. There's still a lot of discussion, and there's been zero guidance since last April, or May actually, around PE. We're still waiting for the Massachusetts Interscholastic Athletic Association to finalise their guidance. There's a lot of umming and ahhing going on across the state about masking indoors. So a lot of sport, the reason they're taking so long to put out PE information or physical education information is that they're trying to decide what will happen with indoor sport and whether they will need to be masked. So that information, we're still waiting for that to come out. At the moment, the children will have PE, they will have their sport, but it'll have to be modified, obviously, to accommodate protocols, etc. And then the other one that there's still a little bit of discussion going on is the arts, or particularly around music and singing, and any instruments that require sort of woodwind or brass instruments that require breathing into. So those will obviously, more information will come out about that as soon as we have it. Clubs and extracurricular are starting again. They will be only within cohorts. So when you're signing up for them, your child will only be doing a club or an extracurricular activity with someone, other children in their same cohort. At the moment, the school will not be offering before school care. The main reason for that is that all of the students would go to one space, and it's quite difficult to actually find enough space for all of the students to go to at the moment, where they're not going to cross over and mix between cohorts. So at the moment, before school care will not be running at the moment, but aftercare will resume. I believe aftercare will probably be starting a couple of weeks into school, not straight away, because they're just having to make sure they get the spacing and the staffing right for that. Weekly testing. Now, this is a big change for us and a very positive change for the school. Last year, we were one of the trial schools to operate pool testing in the state. We were one of the first private schools to start it, and we linked up with the Broad and with CIC Health. And we were one of the very few schools to trial the pool testing. It was very, very effective. It worked well. It was very, very expensive. We applied this year for an approval to get state funding for this. And we were fortunate enough that it came through and we were approved. So there are various different versions of testing that we are eligible for. We have opted at the moment to go with the weekly pool testing that goes through the Broad Lab, which is exactly what it did last year. Last year, what happens with pool testing, for those of you who are not familiar, is that everybody in the school is swabbed. It is very, very non-invasive. It's literally almost just like a cotton bud that goes around the lower part of the nose. The children actually loved it, and they used to start clapping when I walked into the classroom to help with it. They love it, which is slightly sad that they're so used to it now. But anyway, that happens. But what used to happen was 10 swabs would go into one pool. The pool would go off to the Broad. The Broad tested it. If it was negative, the whole pool was negative. If it was positive, we then had to contact every member of that pool and ask them to retest outside school to identify who the positive person was. Time-wise, that wasn't terribly efficient. And also it was kind of annoying for everybody because everyone then had to go and retest to find who the positive person was. We've now been given an option to do a double swab testing, which means that at the time of testing, we will take two swabs from every individual. The first swab will go into the pool along with the 9 others. That will go off and be tested as a pool. The CIC and the Broad will keep aside the second swab, which will go into an individual tube. Those will go along with the pool tests. If a pool returns a positive result, then they pull the 10 individual tests and they test those separately. And that will identify very quickly who is the positive individual. If they all come back negative, they just dispose of all of them and that's it until the next week. So this will be a much more efficient way. It'll be very quick for us to determine who is positive. It'll happen at the same time. So the moment they discover there's a positive pool, they will immediately retest the individual swabs and they move on. And we contact you and everyone will know straight away. There still will be very transparent communication around the testing. Last year, we contacted everybody every week to let you know what the pool results were. That will still happen. It is important that there's transparency around cases in the school, etc. It is really important that everybody fills out the digital consent form. There's a link to it on the reopening plan. We cannot operate, and we're hoping to start this testing next Thursday the 2nd. So it's really important that everybody has filled out the digital consent form. Even if you did it last year, it's a new consent form because it's a new form of testing. So please, can you go on and do that and get it done as soon as possible so that the school can start. One of the other conditions of starting with this pool testing was that we needed to start as clean as possible. When I say clean, I mean as COVID-free as possible. Surprisingly, there have been quite a lot of COVID cases over the summer where a lot of children have had COVID. So it is really important that we find out that make sure everyone is clean before we start the pool testing, because otherwise what happens is the pools go down on the Thursday, we'll suddenly have a whole load of pools that test positive because there are children who still have the virus lurking. One thing that is important, if you could let us know if your child has had COVID over the summer, what happens then is that we do not have them tested for up to 90 days. It is possible that you can continue to test positive after you've had COVID. And obviously then we don't want to put them into the pools because they will keep turning the pools positive. If they have been positive over the summer, they do not need to provide a test to return to school because obviously there's no point. They've done their quarantining and they're clear, and the Department of Health will have cleared them to return to school. One of the things all schools are being asked to do is obviously to keep a very close eye on mental health and social and emotional support. I know the school has been working very closely with the counsellor, director of student welfare, to put together a really sort of solid plan for students and staff to make sure that people, you know, aren't struggling with anxiety. There is a lot of anxiety around all around the world, but with adults and students around coming through this pandemic, I think particularly because people thought that we were going to be a bit further along now, and we're kind of not one thing or the other at the moment. There are a lot of questions around travel. Please follow the state guidance. The state guidance is still a little bit iffy around international travel. We have, as we did last year, asked that people who do travel internationally, particularly unvaccinated children, follow the guidance, and that does mean quarantining if the children are unvaccinated. We have asked for people to make sure that they give us the confirmation of negative testing if you've traveled internationally. Just whizzing through this, there's been a lot of questions around staff vaccinations and whether we have mandated our staff to be vaccinated. No, at present, we have not mandated it, although I will say that when we offered a vaccination clinic last year, 100% of the staff were vaccinated. Obviously, that means that they still are, but any new family, new staff that have come in, we're just following up on that now, but we believe that everybody is vaccinated. We will be able to give percentages, etc., but as it stands at the moment, we do believe that everybody is vaccinated. There's been questions around the remote learning. This is a mandate from the state. None of the schools are allowed to offer remote learning anymore unless it is for a student who is either hospitalized or home hospitalized, or for a student who has an IEP where the doctor has actually written that the student would be better served being remote. Those are the only two reasons that students may stay remote. Unfortunately, the state now does not consider the remote learning part of the 180-day requirement that schools have to do or students have to do in school. That, however, obviously, if a student has to quarantine because they have either contracted or been exposed to COVID, obviously the school will make accommodations to make sure they can access their learning. But what the school is not able to do is to offer a full remote program like they did last year. I'm just going through the questions. Vaccinations. Oh, masks. Yes, there's been questions around masks. Please do follow guidance. CDC have put out a lot of information. There was the link in the reopening plan that I put out about masks as well. There are a lot of resources and links at the bottom of the reopening plan that will be helpful. Please do look at that. We are aware that people are not everyone is going to be happy with the guidance that we've put out there, but our priority obviously is to have the school open in person and for your children to be safe and for our staff to be safe. So apologies if some of these things seem extreme, but obviously we want to make sure that the school is a safe place for your children to come to.
Ems, I'm gonna interrupt you for a moment and just jump in. Thank you for all this incredible information. I wanted to group some of the questions that have come in into a couple of groups. There seem to be some themes that are coming up, most of them related to COVID. But I wanted to maybe ask if several questions came in about one very clear one. Do we need to show negative tests before school starts? We know that's a yes, and you talked about that, even if someone has not traveled outside the United States or even outside of Massachusetts. But one of the questions that's come up is, where do we send our negative or our test results? So do you want to address
Leader Saram has put together a sort of like a sign up genius, but it's a form filler that will be sent out. All you have to do is to fill out when the test was done, when the results came in, and whether it was positive or negative. You do need to do that for each child.
Okay, so remember, families, even if you have, if you have multiple children, please send in a separate form, and you won't have to. Actually, someone asked about where they can obtain a testing form. There's nothing you need to obtain. You'll get some information from Leda Saram, and that will give you the ability to just send us back the information. So that's
and it does helpful. It does need to be a PCR, I'm afraid. So there's been a lot of questions about whether it could be other testing. We are aware that other testing is accepted for airports, etc. But PCR is important to the school because of the state testing that they were then doing afterwards. A lot of people have asked about where to get PCRs done because a lot of places won't test non-symptomatic people. So Project Beacon has still got a few places open. Mass General Brigham Urgent Care offers free testing to everybody, and they are really quick and really good. And there's a lot of testing sites where if you go on to the mass.gov sites, there's a lot of free testing sites with quick turnaround. Yep. So I'm really sorry if this is inconvenient, but it is something that's important for us to be able to start the pool testing straight away.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There was a question about how recent the COVID test should be. I believe we're talking about 72 hours from them coming in on the first day of school.
Prior to starting,
Starting. There were some, there's a question about a digital consent form for weekly testing. That's in the information that was sent out yesterday. And if somebody needs that, there's a link right in there that you can access. So if you have a question about that or a problem, or you need that document, that reopening plan document resent to you, just contact the main office, main.office@bisboston.org, and we will be happy to send you that document again.
There's a lot of questions in here about, will the whole cohort need to quarantine? So no is the answer to that. No, the whole cohort will not need to quarantine. What we are waiting on at the moment is slightly clearer guidance from Boston Public Health around how we would identify close contacts. One of the reasons I had an email that came in before this started about whether students would have assigned seating in classrooms, et cetera. Yes, they should do, because that helps with the contact tracing. The more assigned seating we have in classrooms, in buses, et cetera, the easier it is for the school to do a very quick investigation and identify close contacts. As soon as close contacts are identified, then the families will be contacted and you will be talked through the quarantine expectations. At the moment, there is the guidance from the state does say that unvaccinated people do not need to quarantine. We're just trying to get some clarity from the Board of Health about whether that should apply in the school, because obviously we're nervous about having children who could contract it, but still being in school and carrying it.
Right. There was a question about if you're going out of state, perhaps to New Hampshire for this last wonderful weekend of the summer, you can get tested. You can get your PCR test done anywhere. It probably will end up going back through the Broad, so it'll probably be the same thing. And registering for COVID testing through CHQ, the students do not have to do that. We will take care of all that. We just need you to do that initial, use that link to do the initial paperwork for everyone. And someone asked about getting tests arranged. Every parent does not need to get it done in a private lab. Nope, that will be done, as Em said, through that weekly pool testing. If your child is absent from school, or if they do not come in for that testing, Ems, do you want to address that?
So if your child misses, at the moment, the call I had with CIC Health is that we will be testing on a Thursday. If your child is off from school on a Thursday and misses the testing, they do need to be tested outside school, I'm afraid. If anyone is positive, then you will be contacted. The whole school will know about the pool tests, how many pool tests returned negative or positive results, and then close contacts will be contacted separately. So that we will be very transparent about the communication and about the results, because it is important, obviously, that everybody knows, so that parents can make their own decisions about how comfortable they are with sending their children into school, etc.
Great. There was also a question about, several questions about what would the criteria be for us to actually close the school? So I'm knocking on wood and saying that will never happen. And we got through it last year because of all of you parents and the teachers really, and Em's working really hard. But if we did have to close it, would we be able to move to online learning? We are so fortunate being part of Nord Anglia Education. We showed last year between the 2019-20 year, between March and June, that we have a virtual school experience that is tremendous. And the teachers know how to use it. We have all the support from Nord Anglia. It's gotten even better. As good as it all of you knew it was, it's gotten even better. So we would have, if the whole school, for some unknown reason, if the governor, once again, and that was the only reason we had to close last time, if the governor closed us, we can flip over to the virtual school experience really like that. Your child would not, as several parents said last time, not miss a day of learning. So we're very confident.
I will say that having spoken today with the Board of Health, they actually identified the British school as an example that they have used for other schools around the protocols and the fact that we did not have to close once, apart from for a snow day, which was really annoying last year, but that we didn't have to close at all for COVID. So I do think that we're further down the line now. We are more able to manage positive cases in the school and identify close contacts really, really quickly and contact trace really quickly. I don't think that there would ever necessarily be a need unless there was a very big in-school transmission, which, as I've said, touch wood, did not happen last year and should not happen this year with the protocols in place, or if the city or state mandated it. Those would be the only reasons that it would need to move. But as Lisa said, it would flip very quickly to virtual school if that was the case.
Okay. Let's see. We've addressed the issues of where the test should be done and how we handle if a bubble is positive. And Ems, do you want to go over just one last time, because that has come up a couple times. If someone in the bubble tests positive, could you just go over one more time for everyone exactly what the steps would be and who would be impacted by that?
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course. So if a pool tests positive, then we obviously would very quickly be able to identify who the positive individual was. We would do contact tracing, identify close contacts, and all of the close contacts would be contacted very quickly, and parents would be told their child was a close contact, and they would be asked to follow the quarantine procedure. What that looks like at the moment is what we're waiting on, because as I've said, the Board of Health currently is saying that vaccinated people do not need to quarantine. However, we are slightly pushing for vaccinated children to still quarantine to start with, just while we're making sure, because the Delta variant is definitely proving that it is like unlike anything else that we've experienced before. So if somebody in the bubble did, we would not quarantine the entire cohort. We would not necessarily even quarantine the entire class. We would now just quarantine the students that were immediate close contact. So that could be if they've sat together on the bus, if they have played outside together at a time where they've been unmasked, because remember that when they're outside, they do not need to be masked. So we would obviously need to, the teachers will need to be very alert about outside. The children will know as well who they played with, but the teachers will keep very kind of a good eye on where everybody is and who they're with. And in the classrooms, who they've sat next to, even though they're masked. So again, the reality of the current criteria is that if they're masked and they're 3 feet apart, then basically no one is a close contact. We are being more extreme than that and saying that we believe there are close contacts and we're not going to take that risk. What that exactly looks like at the moment, we're still going backwards and forwards with the Board of Health, and we will get that information out to you, but we will be more extreme than saying no one is a close contact.
Right, fantastic. And in a similar way, the fact that we have been more conservative, which is what enabled us to be open for so long, several questions have come up. Does it have to be a PCR test, this first test of the school year? The answer is yes. Does it have to be 72 hours prior, or when children come into the country who traveled overseas, there's a concern that they'll be missing some school in that first week if they've only come back. They do have to wait 3 days, mm-hmm. because that's when the test will actually be able to accurately, three to five days to be able to accurately tell if they're positive or negative, and then they have to wait for the answer after that. We can't be... we have to be conservative in that. Could you, Ems, one more time go over international travel? Again, we are being more conservative than.
So there's actually a guide in the reopening
document. In that reopening statement, yeah. It's really
there's a guide in there that explains vaccinated, unvaccinated, what people need to do and what we need to do. Yeah. But basically, we are asking that people follow state guidance and quarantine children who are unvaccinated for the period of time. It is literally spelled out in there. There's even a picture to help.
It's a nice bullet point picture you got in there, Ems. That's great.
There is, yes.
Someone asked a related question about a family travel declaration for if the whole family or any members of the family had left the country or even went to a high risk area in the US?
It goes by the child. So as long as we need to know if the children have traveled, not if a member of the family have traveled.
Correct. That changed last year. This person is referencing something that happened in another school last year. We had travel declarations last year as well. The evolving nature of this, Ems is on top of. And so right now, we're asking for information on the child, correct?
Correct. And somebody's also asked around vaccination certificates. How will we know if kids need to quarantine if we're not asking for vaccination certificates? As soon as you are contacted, well, basically, we will have some fairly clear guidance, hopefully, from the Board of Health around whether people need to quarantine. At the moment, we will contact close contacts. We will then ask the family whether the students are vaccinated. But as it stands, I think it's highly likely that we will require vaccinated students to quarantine anyway. So it's not going to make very much difference whether they're vaccinated or not. But if they come back to us and absolutely insist that the vaccinated students do not need to quarantine, then at the point where we contact families to ask to let them know that their child has been a close contact, that would be when we would talk about the vaccination certificate.
Okay, great. If a parent tests positive, will the child have to quarantine, and for how long? Mm-hmm.
So yes, and that's regular state guidance. If they would be a close contact, so yes, they would. There's also a slight difference. So what we've had a situation recently, which I was getting clarification from the Board of Health today about. There's a slight difference around close contacts in school and close contacts in home. So if a child at home tests positive, the other siblings around that child will need to start their quarantining on the last day of the positive person's quarantine, if that makes sense. And they have to quarantine for 10 days. They do not have the option to do the test on day 5 and come out of quarantine on day 8. The reason for that is that they're assuming that if people are in a home, they're not going to be masked and they're going to be around one another much more than if they were in a school where they may or may not have been exposed. We're assuming they've been exposed, but there's a likelihood that they may not have been exposed if they were in school and they're masked and they're 3 feet apart. So if a child is a sibling test positive or a member of the household test positive, the child has to do the full 10 days quarantine. If they are a close contact of somebody in school, then we are looking at whether they can do the test on day 5 and come out of quarantine on day 8, because they will not have been right on top of them like a family member at home.
Right. If there are specific questions if a family has specific questions, they can send them in to us, we can get them to you, and we can answer the very specifics for a particular situation with the family, which may be different when you have that situation than it is today. One person asked about children who returned to the area on Sunday and were tested today. Will they need to be tested again on Friday in order to come into school to have the negative test? Why don't you say this? Because I think I know the answer.
Technically, yes, I'm afraid, because they could still have contracted it between now and then. And I know that that is a real pain. One of the things that a lot of people are saying in here is that a lot of the places are not offering testing on the weekend, which means everyone has to test on the Friday. I would say, and I know that, for instance, airports and stuff say that technically the 72 hours, if you do it on the Thursday night, it's not the end of the world, but we do need to have a recent test. I know that there've been a lot of people, I've had masses of emails, people saying they cannot get a test on Friday and they're not testing over the weekends. I would honestly say that Thursday night is the earliest we could accept a test, but they will be tested again the following Thursday. So, I mean, it's not the end of the world, but I would urge people to test on the Friday if possible. With the people have said that vaccinations actually will be on the students' medical histories, which technically the nurse will have as well. So that is the other option.
Yeah, perfect. And there was, we do have a few questions that are logistical, which we'll get to in a moment. I'm looking at the clock, we are over, but I'm gonna keep it rolling. Vaccination requirements, circling back to eligible age students and staff, we do not have a requirement that eligible children get vaccinated. Ems, do you want to, because there's another question that says, wouldn't vaccination information appear on medical history records? So
that's what I was just saying. So the nurse will have the medical records. There's also questions around why we're not mandating vaccinations. There's nothing to say that will not happen further down the line. That's something that is under discussion as a company, I believe, with Nord Anglia, as to whether we will be mandating vaccinations. So I think that will be something that will be a discussion further down the line. And there's nothing to say that will not happen. I know a lot of private schools are mandating it. I don't know whether we can mandate it for the students at the moment, but with regards to staff, there is a high likelihood that it will be mandated at some point. So that's all I can really share on that.
Yeah. And in a related way, booster shots, which we've all heard quite a lot about, are we gonna ask staff, who were previously vaccinated to get booster shots? And again,
I actually don't know the answer to that. At the moment, the booster shots are only for immunocompromised people. So at this point, the staff are not eligible anyway. But if it becomes something that it becomes available to the staff, I think there's a high likelihood. I mean, I would like to stress that when we offered the vaccination clinic at the school, very kindly hosted by a parent, our staff were very keen to get vaccinated. So none of this is that they're being resistant. All of the staff are desperate to get vaccinated because they want to be safe, just like they want your children to be safe. So I do think that, you know, that will be something that the staff, if they feel, you know, they want to, they're going to go out and do this anyway, without us having to mandate it. But I don't know whether the booster vaccination thing at the moment is not, we're not eligible for it at the moment, apart from compromised people.
And we also, as a reminder to all parents, not only do we offer the vaccination, and all of our teachers took us up on getting the vaccination, but also cleaning staff, the SHOA staff, we really tried to build another bubble around all your children. Over-the-counter COVID PCR tests, are those acceptable, Ems? Over-the-counter PCRs?
I think, yeah, I think as long as it's a PCR test, I think yes.
Okay.
I would say a PCR test is a yes. There have been a few questions around clustering of kids outside the building. So there was information, and it seemed really, when I was writing the information, I was actually slightly embarrassed. I was being so specific about where the children would be waiting. Yeah. But it was very, very specific. So the older children will wait past the hydrant, which when you drive up to school, you will see where the hydrant is.
Between the steam center and the hydrant.
Right. In fact, even on that little picture that we've all got behind us, just a little bit further along from where
the shoulder
is the hydrant. So the hydrant, the older middle and high school students will wait between the hydrant and the steam building, and the younger children will wait outside just where that sign is. But they will come up as the families are contacting the teachers.
Just a couple last questions, everyone, and thank you everyone for your time. We did have a parent write in that Project Beacon, which is in Framingham, Project Beacon sites in Framingham anyway, has a lot of available slots for PCR testing on Saturday the 28th. I will tell you that I was there with my two adult children less than just a couple weeks ago. It was in and out, it was quick, and it was fabulous. And I'm a very persnickety person. So Project
Beacon. And they have Lynn and Revere. They also have sites in Lynn and Revere, and then the Mass General Brigham in Newton is extremely quick, and all you have to do call in the morning to check availability, but they are very, very quick. I have got a couple of questions here that were sent in. I don't want to ignore those. Will the black box dance studio, etc., and some of those common spaces be used this year? Yes, they will do. Will lunchtime clubs be back in full? I am assuming so, but that's something that the school will be able to answer. Will the children have to wear masks outdoors at any time? No. The only disclaimer to that is, depending on what comes back on the sport guidance, that if they're doing something that exerts a lot of breathing outside, that they may be required to wear masks. At the moment, no, they do not need to wear masks when they're outside. We are asking visitors to come who come onto campus, so like for pickup and dismissal, if you're dropping off a child, etc., that you do remain masked while you're on campus, just because there'll be a lot of children around you who are not vaccinated. And so we do ask that you remain masked. When you're
a couple of other recommendations, because I know this is, and I apologize, Ems, but I want to make sure parents hear this, that CIC Health in Cambridge has a lot of appointments for Saturday. CIC Health in Newton has appointments for Sunday. I've used the Newton location, and it's, you stay in your car, they're fabulous, and you're in and out in seconds, and it's very reliable. Also multiple locations at CIC, there may be a BISB. We may have a little flexibility because we've used them before. Do we see masks as a new norm for BISB? We sure hope not. But as long as it's going to keep your children safe, we are going to do whatever we can. The Brigham asks you your nearest location. They have an open appointments for testing on Friday and thereafter. And the MGH Brigham is, I can give you a phone number, folks, 617-724-7000, 617-724-7000, could be an operator. Then there are a few more. There's one last one that's significant, Ems, and I'm if you go to CVS and you schedule a test and say that you're required to test to prevent the spread of COVID, you'll be able to schedule more easily. That's a little tidbit from a parent. And also Harvard Vanguard has testing on Saturdays if you're a patient at, of Harvard Vanguard. So thank you for all those wonderful things. If a child returns from overseas this weekend and have to wait 3 to 5 days as the CDC testing, will that child be able to attend school remotely for the first few days? This has been a discussion, and I don't know if Andy, you want to address that, or Richard, because I know that was something we spoke about at SLT.
Yeah, do you want me to, I'll do it, Richard, if you're okay. Yeah, so we're aware that the guidance came out with only about 2 weeks, within the last 2 weeks, and we're aware then that that wasn't enough time then for some families to change their travel plans. To make sure then that you could get the 72 hours of testing done before you return to school. So yes, about the 180 days that we really need students to be in, that's the part that counts. But you know, what we're gonna do for that first week though, is we are gonna be flexible enough that if a family is traveling internationally and they come back in and they haven't got time to get that 72 hour test done, contact the school, we'll work with you to get your child online for those first few days so that then they can be part of that community as well. Because one thing that we really wanna be careful about is that, yes, in other circumstances throughout the year, that's not going to be okay. But that first day back, we just think it's so important for the students to feel like they're part of this community. And therefore, we want to get as many online as we can within that time. And of course, so that does also count that should any of your tests actually come back negative over the weekend as well, know that we've got virtual provisions and we will be ready on Monday to accept those students in those cases too. If it's just simply through but those are kind of like the circumstances where we will bend those rules slightly, but only for this first week.
Fantastic. Thank you very much for that. And we do have, it is now just after 7. So we've gone a bit over. There are several questions that are related to logistics, non-COVID related logistics. We will get those answered offline, I promise you. A lot of them have to do with where would I drop my child off. Please do read the reopening information that Em's put so much time into and our SLT is reviewed. It's really important, and most of your questions there will be answered. Yes, year 6 and above bring their own devices, and below that they don't have to. But a question came up about, or just an advice, PCR tests bought over the counter will have to be mailed out to FedEx and will take up to 48 hours for a turnaround. So that may not save you anything. Em says it would be okay, but the timing may not be ideal.
There is a couple of questions around children who have tested positive over the summer or within the past 90 days. If you could please email me, I've started to compile a list which I've shared with the nurse of students who obviously will not be able to provide a PCR when they return to school because they have tested positive and they have fulfilled the Board of Health's quarantine time. So they are given clearance to return to school. So if you could let us know who those children are or if your child is one of those that has tested positive, and then we will keep them out of the pool testing so they don't throw off the pools. And obviously they do not need to provide the school with a PCR test if they have tested positive over the summer.
Fantastic. The one last question, which went back to a very beginning, was about how we will know if the school is 80% vaccinated and will we eventually be asking for proof of vaccination? So
I can answer that. At some point, yes, we probably will be asking for proof of vaccination. However, at the moment, no. And it's going to be quite a long time before the school is at 80%. Just as a heads up, bearing in mind that half the school are unvaccinated and underage at the moment. So it is going to be quite a long time. So I would put it out there that people probably should be prepared that the children will be masked and testing for a while.
We are doing what we think is going to keep everybody safe and keep the learning live, and we know how critical and how wonderful it was this year. Other questions about lunches and dismissal, again, as Em said, go with what your younger child, what's appropriate for the younger child in the group, but please reread. And I'm just looking other non-COVID related things. We will take care of all that. I think blazer and tie, yes. If your child is in middle or high school, they should have their blazer and tie, but if there's a delay, don't worry about things. Just get your kids in here, put them as close to the uniform as possible, and let's get this party started again, right? And I think the rest about lunches, gluten-free options, we'll have to check that out and get back to you. Buses, we do have a buddy system. Not on the buses, we will have the children spaced, as Em said, separate from each other, but we do pick your children up and deliver them to the bus from their classroom. So a year three child will be picked up by a staff member, brought up to the buses, and we make sure they get on the bus safely, and then we will greet them when they come in the morning. And I believe we have done it. The drop off again, we'll get to those, but we will get these resolved. I think we did it. I think that we got all the questions answered, at least for right now. And it is just 6 minutes past, or 3 minutes past seven.
Sadly, everyone is a pro at COVID. That's what it is. That's
exactly it. And especially you. I am thrilled. I'm going to ask Richard if he wants to say a final goodbye. Andy has anything to say, but I will say from the bottom of my heart, I want to thank all the parents, the staff, the administration, and EMS. The fact that we got a shout out from the state in terms of doing the right thing last year and being a beacon of how to keep your children learning live and doing it in a safe and reasonably sane way is a great testament to the work that all of you did, and especially that EMS did. And we're all very happy that she's staying on to help us continue this COVID journey. And I will officially now say I'm going to pass to Richard and then to Andy, and then I will let our COVID queen give a goodbye as well.
Thanks.
Thank you very much, Lisa. Well, I think to echo Lisa's comments, I, as the head of school, just want to acknowledge the huge amount of work that Emma has done, and just how much the whole of the school here has appreciated that. Because obviously, as you can imagine, there's many things to do in preparing all of the things that Emma spoke about. And not just that, of course, preparing for the beginning of the new academic year. And so without Emma, it would have been very difficult to be in the place that we are. We feel confident that we can keep your children safe. I think children coming to school, it's vitally important, not just from the academic point of view, but obviously from the social and well-being point of view, that children are able to come to school. And school fulfills many roles, not just the academic one. And that contributes to their well-being, their mental health, and so on. So we hope, and I think we have, struck the balance correctly between achieving that and opening the school and keeping it safe, and delivering the face-to-face education we know that is so valuable for your child's well-being and development. But I would say a huge thank you to Emma. And as a new incoming head of school, I can say her expertise, her calm temperament, and the experience that she's gained has been invaluable. And I'd just like to thank her both personally and professionally for that. I hope you all, as parents, I appreciate that some people, you know, may not agree with some of the things, but we hope, as I say, we've struck that right balance, which will keep your children safe, but will keep them learning as well. So a huge thank you to you as parents for your support over the last year for Darren and his team. And I look forward to meeting you literally next week. So that's going to be a very exciting day for me. And I've been assigned a gate duty. So if you happen to be at that gate, I look forward to meeting you. I think Andy will be at another point. And so it depends on which way you come in as to who you get on Monday morning. But I look forward to meeting you all. And I, as I say, I hope we've struck the right balance, but I would like to just finish by thanking Emma for the huge amount of work, advice and guidance she's given us in arriving at this point. So thank you very much. And I look forward to seeing you all, or as many as possible, on Monday.